musicians may be seated in the house of the Lord. We greet you in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord. It is good to be here this day. It is good to see each of you in the house of the Lord. I'm almost persuaded to ask the question, where is the multitude from last Sunday? Bless the Lord. We are grateful for your presence. Amen. To the presiding person of our worship this morning, came back. Thank you so much. Bless you. And then a special thanks to a team of ministers who participated this morning. Sister Monica, thank you so much for the pastoral prayer this morning. Bless you. Elder Chung for the reading of Scripture. Thank you. Amen. I have to confess, it was an exciting time for me yesterday. It was a good time, and I think it was a successful event as we were able to pull together the leadership of this church in an attempt to move us into the five-star church. And I think we had a good time. Amen. Those of you who were able to make it, those of you who were not able to make it, you need to see me this week. Amen. There are just some requirements that if you're going to be in leadership that you need to be a part of. Just no way around. Bless your heart. Love you much. But there's just some requirements. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Bless you. Stand with me for just a moment for the reading of God's word. Pastor Story, once again, it's good to see you, my brother. Sister Story, God bless you. Thank you for being here with us this morning. For those of you I've not seen in a while, it is good to see each of you. Thank you for coming and for worshiping with us this morning. From the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 31 through 10, from the New International Version, I read it again. The word says, when all these blessings and curses I set before you come on you, and you take them to heart wherever the Lord your God disperses you among the nations. And when you and your children return to the Lord your God and obey him with all your heart and with all your soul, according to everything I command you today, then the Lord your God will restore your fortunes and have compassion on you and gather you again from all the nations where he scattered. Even if you've been banished to the most distant land under the heavens, from there the Lord your God will gather you and bring you back. He will bring you to the land that belonged to your ancestors, and you will take possession of it. He will make you more prosperous and numerous than your ancestors. The Lord your God will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your descendants, so that you may love him with all your heart and with all your soul. The Lord your God will put all these curses on your enemies who hate and persecute you. You will again obey the Lord and follow all his commands I'm giving you today. Then the Lord your God will make you most prosperous in all the work of your hands and in the fruit of your womb, the young of your livestock and the crops of your land. The Lord will again delight in you and make you prosperous just as he delighted in your ancestors. If you obey the Lord your God and keep his commands and decrees that are written in this book of the law, and turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated in the house of the Lord. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for the opportunity to fellowship together this day. We thank you for allowing us to worship. And that's to show forth that, God, we believe you're worthy of all the praise that we can. Forgive us for our negligence. Forgive us for our sins. Forgive us when we are so short-sighted that we don't do what you asked us to do. Help us to worship today and to seek your face. It's in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, we pray for things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Again, it is so good to see each of you this morning. Brother Alex, thank you so much, man. for all that you do. Amen. Bless you. He is always making sure everything's recorded, making sure that the pictures go on Facebook, the internet, making sure that Second Baptist is just out there. That's good. We're grateful for your commitment. Recently, we went to Connecticut, Waterbury, Connecticut, this past week. And you know, whenever you get together with family, you always have a tendency to pull out the albums. And you gather up all the pictures that were hidden away in the boxes. And when you start to take a look at those pictures in the boxes, you remember when you used to actually weigh that. You look at those old photographs and you think to yourself, man, I did have hair then. And then sometimes we look at others and we think, yeah, back then it was black. I had a waistline. Just all those fond memories. And then you look at those pictures and you think, where is this person? And you think, where is that person? Mm-hmm. Not only do we look at albums and look at pictures and recall individuals that meant so much to us, those that are still here, and then there are fleeting memories of individuals who have left us as we look over. There's another area of our lives that we have a tendency to look at things differently. Every time I go back to the hood, we sometimes hear that word hood and we think of it as a negative thing. But all of y'all from the hood. Because hood just means neighborhood. So all of us have a neighborhood that we are from. Now, when I go home and I meander through the neighborhood that has changed, roads have shifted, it was once two-way, now it's one-way, it was once going east, now it's going west. Where there used to be housing units there in one particular area, now it's an open field or it is individual housing in the neighborhood. And so often when I go home, inside the neighborhood, I'm trying my best to put some names with some faces. Because every time I go back into the hood, I'm looking for people that came along with me. Or didn't. This morning's message is about remembering. Whenever we look at the book of Deuteronomy, Deuteron meaning two or second, Deuteronomy meaning telling the story for the second time. It is the second time that Moses has decided to tell the same story. Have you ever written across one of those stories, events in your life that meant so much to you? That every time you get to talking about a certain situation, it always conjures up memories of that same event. And you begin again telling that story. I've been around long enough now, particularly the family, that when certain things are said, it triggers certain memories. And then all of a sudden, Mother Lords, I start to tell some stories they've already heard. You ever been around family members and they can almost finish your story with you? Because you remember some events that were so important to you that you deemed it necessary to tell it again. It is 1407 to 1406 BC. The beginning of this book is written by the lawgiver Moses. The closing section of it is written by Joshua. It is believed that they are on the east side of the Jordan River. They have recently left Egypt. Joseph is dead. They've been released from bondage. And now on the eastern side of the Jordan River, they are looking longingly towards the promised land. God has already made an agreement with them, a covenant, that if they live according to his laws, he was willing to bless them and to be with them. But like most people, even while on the eastern side of the Jordan, there's a segment of individuals who are there who are not so sure. They come all this way to go through what they're going through to get to what he has for them. Am I talking to anybody this morning? The Israelites are seated there, and Moses has paused momentarily, trying to encourage them and help them to understand that the reason why you are stationary in life right now is because you've not kept your part of the bargain. Hence the pericope of scripture that deals with the fact that God says, before I can take you in, I've got to at least circumcise your heart. 40 years, it wasn't the distance that kept them from getting to the promised land, it was the condition of their hearts. For some of us, it is not because it is that far away from us, but it is rather because our relationship is that far removed from where God wants us. It becomes extremely difficult to do what God has asked us to do when we ourselves are not so sure we want the promised land. Amen. God is asking in this passage, first off, Israel, I need you to trust me. In the 21st century, in most of our lives, we have a trust issue. In many instances, we've been hurt so often, we've been maligned so frequently, we've been ostracized so much that many of us don't want to trust anybody. And so God says, first off, Smith, when you see them on Sunday, help them to understand, I need them to trust me. If I bring you out of bondage, taking you towards somewhere that is promised, at least trust me to get you there. Yeah. Yeah. Let's be honest. 4 million people that Moses is leading from Egypt to the promised land is no easy feat. When you've got 15 people in a ministry that you are attempting to lead, you know as well as I do, there will always be at least one Judas, one Thomas, one Peter, one Bartholomew. They will always be in the midst of the individuals that you are tempted to lead, because there will always be one that wants to cuss and cuss. There will always be one that wants to doubt whether or not you are capable of doing what you say you're capable of doing. There will always be segments of pockets of individuals, not only in life, in the church, and at home. Come on, talk to me, somebody. Don't look at me like I'm speaking some foreign language. Help me out with this thing. And so he says, God says, not only do I want you to trust me, second point that you need to do is obey me. Because I want you to obey me. If I made a promise to your forefathers,
that I would bless them above their wildest imagination. Obey me and watch what happens to you. He's already made a promise in this text. If you do what I commanded you to do, I'll make you so prosperous, even your enemies will be jealous. I didn't make that up. Listen to that. We're trying to get people to follow in places that they don't want to go. Stop trying to get people to go where they don't want to go. An 11-day journey took them 40 years. 40 years for God to wipe out a generation of individuals. Wow. What kind of God is that? That would wipe out a whole generation of people because God wanted people who were going to love him and obey him. Trust and obey. And the third point is love. Did you know that God created you so that you could love him? And so that he can love you. And he says, if in fact you'll keep my commandments and do what I've asked you to do, I'm going to make you so prosperous. And in that passage of scripture, all of a sudden Moses deals with what we call the great eschaton. He shifts for a moment and pushes us from the Old Testament into what transpires in the New. He gives us a promise, and God always allows us to remember some stuff so that we can transition from where we used to be. So he can place us where he wants us to be. He wants to bless us. He wants to build us up. He wants to make us prosperous. He said, I'm going to give you more than you ever imagined. I'm going to open up toes wounds. I'm going to help your livestock be productive. I'm just going to bless you, and then I'm going to take the curses, and I'm going to curse those who are against you. I didn't make it up. It's in the text. Read the text. All I'm trying to suggest to you today, as we come together to celebrate the great feast, we are to remember what God has done. You know where you came from. You know what your life was like. But guess who brought you from that point to this point? You remember when you were miserable? But God gave you joy. And we believe that if God gives us joy, kingdom got to take it away from us. Yeah. He deals with the eschaton. The eschaton is the last day. He has moved and shifted to help us understand that in the last days, in that great millennial, God's going to do something to bless us beyond our wildest imagination. He's going to change the setting of where we live and bless our lives. Whatever you do, don't forget that the Lord has blessed you. You've not been that good. You've not been that perfect. You are not that strong. You are not that wise. God to you, so that you rejoice in what he's done over your life. Hallelujah, somebody. For the Lord is blessing us. And I'm glad God doesn't go back on his promise. He says, spend I'll be with you even until the ends of the earth. When it's all said and done, when I've gone through all the suffering, the heartache, the loneliness, God says, trust him, to obey him, and to love him. That's my message this morning. Bless you. Real, real good today. Come on, stay with me. I'm taking some wrong turns in life. I misread the map a time or two. Thank you. If you're here today, the Spirit has spoken to you. Now would be a good time for you to give your life to Christ. Just remember where you've come from, what He's done for you. Just remember that the God that we serve is bigger than the situation. Just remember that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And if you're here this day, we invite you to come and give your life to Christ. That means that you are not a part of a church. And you'd like to make this the place where you will mature in your faith more. That means that if in fact you have been a part of a church and walked away, now is the time to come back. That means that if in fact the place where you're united with your church is too far away, and you need a place where you can have a comfort, a place where you can grow and draw closer to Christ, now is the time to make a decision to do just that. Is the one you're for.
Come, we will wait for you. There are many open seats up closer.